So your images turn out too dark or too bright at times? What if I told you exactly why that happens and how you can avoid that? Here we go. Let's say you want to photograph a sheet of black paper and a sheet of white paper. The camera can measure the brightness of both subjects, but it doesn't know what it is actually looking at. And not knowing what it is looking at, it doesn't know what to output it to. For example, white paper in the middle of the night is darker than black paper in sunlight. How does the camera know that it needs to output the white paper as white and the black paper as black? The truth is, it doesn't know at all, it only assumes. And that assumption is that both the white paper and the black paper are actually grey. And that's why it will output both with the very same brightness, which is right in the middle between white and black. Why in the world does the camera think it's grey? Or to be precise, medium or middle grey? That middle already holds the answer, because that assumption is a historical average. Back in the days when camera manufacturers started developing auto-exposure modes, or in other words, the in-camera metering that helps us expose our images up to this very day, they needed to come up with a reference. Because it is one thing to measure the light, but not knowing what you are photographing, you don't know what to do with that measurement. So they looked at thousands of images to create a reference and found out that the average brightness of all those images is exactly middle bright. I see you're looking at me in disbelief or maybe in total confusion, so let me quickly prove that to you. Photoshop has a function that lets me display the average of images. Let me start with a black image and a white image. They are both on separate layers, stacked over one another. For those of you who use Photoshop and want to follow along, I right-click on the selected layers and choose Convert to Smart Objects. Now I can go to Layer, Smart Object, Stack Mode and tell Photoshop how it shall display the stacked layers. I choose Mean because that will display the average of the layers. And we end up at middle gray, so the exact average between white and black. Okay. But that was only white and black. What if I do the same with two images instead? Let me use an image of a dead bee on white background. If you want to know the full sad story, you can watch my focus stacking tutorial on YouTube. And as a second image, I'll choose a shot of soap bubbles on black background. I convert both layers together to a smart object and let Photoshop calculate the mean. The background is again the average between white and black, which is middle grey, and the other parts of the images are also averaged, but they are nowhere near grey. If you had a statistics class, you have learned that two samples are not really statistics. You need many, many more samples to create a serious mean value. So let's do that. I have opened 120 images from the past few years as layers. What do we have here? A dark image of a deep sky?
Bright images in snow, macros, landscapes, wedding shots, birds, aerials, blue, another one yellow,
a red one, the moon, you name it. Just a random mix of images that are prepared for my Instagram. By the way, that is wolf.amri if you quickly want to pause and follow me there. Are you curious about the output? This is the mean of those 120 images. Pretty grey and pretty uniform if you ask me. If I take 240 images, it will get even more uniform, and so on and so forth. Now imagine you took all the shots you will ever take in your life. I promise it will be pure grey and absolutely monochrome, so only one colour. So the average brightness of an image is in fact middle grey, and that is why cameras try to output everything we photograph to that colour. That works way more often than you may think. For example, this landscape. The average brightness of this image between the white snow and the dark shady areas is middle grey. So the camera would expose that pretty well. Also for this image. The blue background is medium bright and the average between the white petals and the dark branch is also medium bright. But then there are those statistical outliers like white snow or black charcoal. Outputting them as middle grey is a pretty bad idea. And that is where you as a photographer need to tell the camera,
"My friend, I disagree with your decision."
The easiest way of doing that is a function called exposure compensation. In any auto or semi-auto mode, or even in manual exposure when using auto ISO, you can either use the camera's dedicated dial for exposure compensation, if it has one, or if it doesn't, you have to press the +/- button and then use the main dial to change exposure compensation. Then you can dial in a positive compensation, if you want a brighter image than the one suggested by your camera, or a negative compensation, if you want a darker image. And there is another tool that helps you getting the correct exposure, limiting the area that the camera measures. For example, if you want to photograph the moon. Instead of letting the camera meter to complete frame, you can tell it to meter a much smaller area, a spot. And that's why this metering mode is called spot metering. You can set that in the menu of your camera, and it is not only helpful for the moon, but also, for example, for backlit portraits and other stuff. You can, of course, also combine spot metering with exposure compensation. And you can even combine spot metering with manual exposure to get the exposure indicator that I introduced you to in lesson 6 to only meter the area within that spot. One thing I have to tell you though, even if you get the exposure 100% correct, chances are that you still over and or underexpose parts of your images. Reason being is that our eyes, again, are much better than our cameras and are able to capture a much bigger so-called dynamic range. What is dynamic range? It is the number of stops. Remember, you learned about stops in lesson 5. So the number of stops a specific camera can capture within a single image before it starts displaying the pixels on the bright side as purely white and on the black side as purely black. That can be particularly frustrating when you just change from your smartphone over to a dedicated camera, because smartphones heavily edit the images in camera, which a dedicated camera doesn't do as well. What are examples where that happens? For example, shooting against the light if you have a milky bright sky and photograph a landscape against that light. The landscape will look good, but the sky will be all white. Photographers call that blown out. The same with portraits against such a sky. This happens more often than you may think, and it is something that you can avoid by carefully planning a shot and making sure you shoot in the right direction at the right time. More on that in the last lesson of this course. So far so good, but how can you actually make sure your shot is neither too bright nor too dark? I told you before that the display, while getting you pretty close, is not something you can 100% rely on. There are a few ways to do that. Most photographers will tell you to use the histogram. That is a bar graph in your camera that tells you how the brightness levels in your images are distributed. If the histogram shows more and or higher bars on the right, it means your image is rather bright. Many photographers will tell you the image is overexposed if the histogram looks like this. Well, would you say this image is overexposed? Probably not. Similarly, they will tell you the image is underexposed if the histogram looks like this. Is my image of the moon underexposed? Nope, not really. Using the histogram to judge whether a regular image is over or underexposed needs a lot of experience. And for beginners, I would not recommend using it for that purpose. What you could use it for, though, is to judge whether the whites or blacks in an image are correctly exposed. For example, in our image of the white paper, we rather want the paper to be almost completely white. But the image should still retain a few so-called details in the white areas. That's why we just want it to slightly touch the right side. So we keep changing the exposure until the histogram just barely touches the right side. A real-life example would be this bug that I photographed on the petals of a white flower. You want the flower to still contain some details rather than having it pure white. For your info, I have used a flash for that. I'm working on macro photography classes to teach you the ins and outs. Same with black paper. It's supposed to be almost, but not complete black. So changing the exposure according to our histogram, we can make sure that there are still some details left. Unfortunately, not all images contain something that is white or black, so the histogram isn't always as easy to judge. If you're still interested, I have a YouTube video that explains it in great detail. Another helpful tool that will help you improve exposure is the so-called zebra function. Not all cameras have that, but many do. What is it all about? There are actually two ways how you can use zebras. First, you can set a certain value for the zebra, and the camera will overlay the zebra pattern over anything that is brighter than the set value. If you set it to the maximum possible level, you will get a zebra over everything that is going to end up completely white in your final image. So you know you can't even bring them back in your editing software. The second way of using zebra patterns is to expose for skin tones. On many cameras you can set a certain zebra value, and everything within the value will show a zebra pattern. I have set mine to 70 to expose the skin of my wife. Now when I set my exposure, I try to get the zebra pattern over the brightest parts of my wife's skin. That will make exposing skin tones a breeze, and you will always have perfect exposures on faces. Luckily, we have a beautiful variation of skin tones on this planet. If you photograph black people's skin, you should set zebra to around 50. However, zebras work slightly different on different cameras. So I'd recommend getting your manual or Googling your camera name, zebra and exposure to find the best information. One last thing I want to mention about exposure and metering is using spot metering to meter faces. If you shoot against a bright background, metering the complete frame will get you a dark face and a medium bright background, because the camera doesn't know that you want to concentrate on the face. Now, if I set the camera to spot metering again and let it meter my face, the exposure will concentrate on that and basically ignore the background. That again could lead to a totally overexposed background. Not everyone's cup of tea either, and there are workarounds how to avoid that. But I need to ask you for some patience. I will introduce you to those in the last lesson of this course that is all about light and lighting. Either way, as you may have realized, my skin is that of an old white man. And the brightness of white people's skin matches pretty well with the brightness of a so-called gray card. That's why spot metering works well for white people. That has nothing to do with camera manufacturers being racists, but just with the coincidence that the brightness of white skin is similar to medium gray that is so important for exposure. But what if the skin of the people you want to photograph is not white? Why not just try that? I have invited Austria's best triple jumper to this lesson. Welcome to the fabulous Andy King, the King. Thanks for modeling for us, Andy.
Thank you for having me. Let's do something great.
I'm afraid we won't create all that spectacular images today because we will only talk about spot metering, but we will save that for an upcoming flash photography course. If you want to follow the journey of this young amazing athlete who will have probably broken the Austrian record and competed at the Olympic Games by the time you watch this, check out his Instagram at andy_king1. So if we now do the same as before, namely spot metering Andy's face, we will see that the camera would overexpose the image. Logically it does, because his skin is darker than the medium gray that cameras are calibrated to. But the camera will still try to output it as medium gray. What can we do? You know that already. We can use the exposure compensation. Usually a compensation of -1 to -1 2/3 gives you a pretty good result. Now that you really understand how exposure and metering works, you are prepared for any lighting situation that you will ever encounter. If you still don't fully understand, you know that repetition will help you, and so will the Wolf method. If you have enrolled to the Wolf method, you will now nail everything into your brain with the next drill training. And after that, I will see you in the next lesson, which is the favorite lesson of most people: composition.